Facing Both Ways by A.W. Tozer. Like a doctor with a sick patient whose disease eludes diagnosis, religious leaders have for some years been aware that there is something seriously wrong with evangelicalism and have yet been unable to lay their finger upon the precise trouble. The symptoms they have discovered in abundance, but the cause behind them has been hard to locate. Mostly we have spent our time correcting symptoms, having all the while an uneasy feeling about our remedies that did not go deep enough. One odd mark of the disease of which we speak is an impulse on the part of the patient to jump up and down and shout that he never felt better in his life. Yet, if the New Testament and the example of eminent saints represent a normal state of spiritual health, our patient is not only below standard, but actually gravely ill. Knowledge that a disease that cannot be identified invariably calls out a flock of untrained experts to analyze and prescribe. We yet risk a pronouncement upon the condition of evangelical Christianity in our day, and we believe we may not be too far from the truth. The trouble seems to be a disorder of the spiritual nerve system, which we might, for lack of a proper term, call dual orientation. Its dominant characteristic appears to be crossed wires among the nerve ganglia of the soul, resulting in an inability to control the direction of the life. The patient starts in one direction, and before he knows it, he is going in another. His inward eye do not coordinate. Each one sees a different object and seeks to lead the steps toward it. The individual is caught in the middle, trying to be true to both foci of the heart and never knowing which he would rather follow. Evangelicalism, at least in many circles, is suffering from this strange division of life purpose. Its theology faces towards the East and the sacred temple of Jehovah. Its active interests face towards the world and the temple of Dagon. Doctrinally, it is Christian, but actually it is a pagan mentality, pagan scale of values, and pagan religious principles. Let a man but become, as the early Methodists would have said, soundly converted, and certain things will begin to happen in his life. He will experience a wonderful unification of personality and a turning about of the whole life toward God and heavenly things. Though he will undoubtedly suffer from the inward struggle described in the 7th chapter of Romans, yet his direction will be established beyond any doubt, and his face will remain turned towards the city of God. The word direction should have more emphasis these days, for the most important thing about a life is its direction. David hardly said anything more significant than this: I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. And the Hebrews writer summed it all up in one sentence: looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. An emotional conversion which stops short of Christ orientation is inadequate for life and death, and unless new help comes from some quarter, it may easily be worse than no religious experience at all. And just this would appear to be the source of our bad orientation. The original experience of conversion was not sufficiently radical to turn the life wholly to God and things eternal. Then when the religious leaders found that, they had on their hands a half-converted person who wanted to be saved but would not turn fully to God. They tried to meet the situation by providing a twilight zone religion which did not demand too much and which did not that offer something. Better have them halfway in, they reasoned, than all the way out. We know now how bad that reasoning was. With large blocks of evangelicals praying and preaching like Christians, while they live and talk like worldlings, how much longer may we expect them to remain evangelical? Apostasy always begins with a conduct. First, there is a wrong orientation of the life, a facing towards the lost world with yearning and enjoyment. Later, there comes a gradual surrender of the truth itself and the slipping back into unbelief. This has happened to individuals and denominations, and it can happen to the whole present evangelical communion if it is not checked before it is too late. For this cause, the facing both ways attitude of our present Christianity is something to be alarmed about. And if that attitude were the result of plain backsliding, there would be much more reason for optimism. Unchristian acts done by a Christian through weakness and over the protests of his better heart may be bad enough, but they are not likely to be fatal. But when he does them with the sanction of his teachers and with a belief that they are all part of the Christian way, how is he to be rescued?